There are nearly two dozen major candidates running for president this year, and the ones getting the most attention are not all elected officials. They are the outsiders: Donald Trump, Ben Carson, Bernie Sanders, Carly Fiorina, using YouTube, Instagram, and other social media to build huge followings and get onto debate stages. But is this really brand new, or have we been here before? We turn to three political historians: Lara Brown, who directs George Washington University's Graduate School of Political Management, and NewsHour regulars Michael Beschloss, the author of 9 books, and Richard Norton Smith, whose most recent book was on the life of Nelson Rockefeller. So, Michael Beschloss, a lot of people are running. We seem to be paying attention to them, but the ones catching fire are not necessarily the politicians, or at least seen or perceived as being the politicians. How unusual is that?
Well, it has happened before a lot in history, and maybe the best example of that would have been Ross Perot in 1992. What he basically said was, I'm a businessman, I've never held public office, and that means I'm not implicated in these party establishments that have taken the country the wrong way. So he went on Larry King in February of 1992, and he said, you know, if you Americans want me to run, I'll run as a third party candidate, and I will attack the federal deficits, which neither party is doing anything about. So he allowed himself, at least in his language, to be recruited. He ran, and at one point early that year, at least in the late spring, he was running ahead of George H.W. Bush and Bill Clinton, the two major party candidates.
And he was a third party candidate, but we've seen people, even from the establishment parties, Lara Brown, who have broken out of this and changed up the whole feel of an election race before.
Well, I think that's right. I mean, what we really have to do is make a distinction. And that distinction is those who call themselves outsiders, who really mean they're just outside Washington, versus those who call themselves outsiders because they're outside of politics altogether.
For example?
Well, for example, we can see the governors who run. They often say things like, you know, I'm outside of Washington. I'm going to go and fix that government and get it back on track. We've seen that with Jimmy Carter. We've also seen that with Ronald Reagan. But then you do have those who say that they're outside of politics altogether, and certainly Ross Perot fits that model. As Michael Beschloss has written, so too has Wendell Willkie.
Wendell Willkie. You never get to use Wendell Willkie. Okay, Richard Norton Smith, there's your cue. Who is your favorite outsider who people didn't see as someone who was part of the establishment and managed to upend things?
Well, actually, you go back 200 years. Andrew Jackson transformed American politics and in many ways reinvented the American presidency, running as an outsider. Certainly the establishment was horrified. It's one of the great set pieces of American democracy, the scene of Inauguration Day 1829, when Jackson and his fellow Westerners descended on the town, took it over, and it was never quite the same. At the end of the 19th century, you had William Jennings Bryan, who gave voice to the feelings of mostly Southern and Western farmers and others who felt victimized by Wall Street. I mean, a lot of this is, the question is, what are you outside of?
Right.
It's not only the Washington establishment that they run against, but in oftentimes the economic policies that that it represents and that in turn are centered symbolically on Wall Street.
Michael, let's go back to Jimmy Carter, who Lara mentioned. There were 17 candidates, Democratic candidates for president in 1976.
Right.
It's remarkable.
It is, and that's one reason why Jimmy Carter packaged himself as an outsider. And to some extent, that was a big sham, because Jimmy Carter had been in politics for over a decade. He'd been in the Georgia State Senate, been governor of Georgia, but he knew that in the wake of Watergate, and also with all these other people to differentiate himself from, it would be most helpful for him to say, I'm not from Washington, I'm not a lawyer. That was very much with design. And as Lara mentioned, the same thing with Ronald Reagan when he ran for president in 76. His announcement speech, he said, elect me because I'm not part of the Washington buddy system. And yes, he was not from Washington, but I wouldn't nominate Ronald Reagan as, you know, with pitchforks and the first person who's going to overthrow the establishment.
Well, let's think about this for a moment. Are outsiders outsiders because they themselves represent something new and different, or is it because of what the mood of the American public is at the time, Lara Brown?
Well, a lot of it is a reaction. They're trying to essentially claim legitimacy to a feeling that is in kind of reaction to something else that is going on. So as we've discussed, you know, Jimmy Carter, Carter came about because there was Watergate. There was this opportunity. You know, you can also look back to, in fact, 1924, when John Davis wins the nomination at the Democratic Party convention after 103 ballots. There are issues in that election because William McAdoo had been caught up in the Teapot Dome scandal and had taken money from Edward Doheny. So there was a sense that he was corrupted and that that nomination should not go to him. So there is this way in which outsiders come in, or there is essentially surfeit ambition, a number of candidates running when there are opportunities to do so.
Well, we certainly are familiar with surfeit ambition in any campaign, but certainly in this one. So let me ask you, to Richard Norton Smith, a little bit about what this does to the process. What does this actually change or weaken the establishment parties? This, the rise of the Donald Trumps, the rise of the Wendell Willkies, or does it just is it just predictable?
Traditionally, and I emphasize traditionally, it's been a blip. I mean, there was no age of Wilkie, that's for sure. And who knows what will happen over the next few months. What is, however, seemingly unique about this, and we saw some of this particularly on the Republican side 4 years ago, when, if you remember, there were a number of unconventional candidates who stressed the fact that they were not part of the Washington establishment. Both Jimmy Carter and Ronald Reagan, in effect, went to the electorate with a case that we're outsiders, we're not part of the mess, but we have the right experience, we have the right skill set as governors of major states to fix what is wrong. What is really unusual about this set of professed outsiders is that they are running against the very qualifications that have traditionally been viewed as necessary to be a successful president.
And I wonder, Michael, whether this is all sped up because of the rise of the internet or conservative radio.
Absolutely.
That people who maybe would have just thought about running before now have instant platforms.
And for most of American history, if you wanted a major party nomination, you would have to be chosen by office holders, and office holders would have been the last people who would have chosen someone who had not run for office or served before. So this is something that's relatively new. But Richard also makes a good point, and that is that outsiders do wonderfully when people are really angry about something, but if there's an overwhelming issue of foreign policy, Americans probably going to think twice about giving the keys to someone who doesn't have that kind of experience. Ross Perot got 19% in 1992. One reason he could do that is that the Cold War was over and the country seemed as peaceful as it had been for a long time.
So does a protest candidate, just for the sake of protest, does that actually add to or perhaps enhance our political process, Lara?
Well, throughout most of history, what protest candidates have really done is raised issues that the major candidates have then adopted or co-opted, and they've moved on to essentially express those ideas in their platforms, in their campaigns, and if they've won, their presidencies. In fact, you can see the focus of both Bill Clinton and Newt Gingrich on issues surrounding the budget as really being about those issues that Ross Perot was raising in 92.
And I remember Richard covering Jesse Jackson in 1988, 1984. He was an outsider candidate who brought up issues nobody else brought up.
He was, absolutely, and had significant, lasting impact. You go back a few years earlier, a very different candidate, an outsider named George Wallace, who ran first in the Democratic primaries in 64 and then a third party campaign in 68. He never came close to winning, but there's no doubt that he had a disproportionate impact both on the debate that year and arguably on the heralding a conservative wave that really incorporated not only the Nixon presidency, but for a couple decades thereafter. He was an agent of change who had a transforming effect, even though he never won the presidency.
Okay. Well, we'll be watching for that disproportionate or maybe proportionate effect in this election year. Richard Norton Smith, Michael Beschloss, Lara Brown. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Pleasure. Thanks.